Good day. I'm Robert Vallis, President and CEO of Signature Resources. We are a high-grade Canadian gold exploration firm working to grow and expand our land package and our discovery in hand. We have a high-quality asset in northwestern Ontario near the border of Manitoba. We hold nearly 234,000 ounces there. In the prolific Northern Red Lake District. It's within a massive land package with obviously huge regional gold potential. This covers nearly 90% of the entire Lingman Lake Greenstone Belt within our claim package. So the district level potential for further discovery is significant. And we have entered into the growth phase. We are through our initial funding and our just recently completed 3,000 meter initial drill program, looking and working to step out and expand the scale of this discovery that we have in hand. And of course, all of that is towards eventually achieving a 43-101 compliant resource, moving the historical resource into that compliance, along with significant expansion of scale, what we hope to be grade and ounces.
Robert, hello. How are you?
Hey.
Thanks for joining us.
How are you?
All good. So where in the world are you?
I'm just outside of Toronto, Ontario, Canada, here in a city called Oakville.
Fantastic. Okay, well, like, first time we've met, first time we've spoken. Story's new to me too. But there's a historic component to this. You've got a resource, but it's historic. You've got a bit of data, but it's historic. So what did you guys set out to do?
Well, once obtaining then the claims that contain that historic resource, we set out to really validate that historic resource by digging into the integrity of the data. In 2018, there was twin hole drilling done, 22 drill holes twin drilled, as well as a number of re-assays on the existing historic core, of which we hold in hand about 80% still exists in excellent condition. All of those results came back, Matthew, about 94% correlation. So that was significant as well. Several of the twin drill holes actually graded better than the holes they were twinning. When we combine that with data sets that we had dug into, such as the existing workings that are there, shaft, three sublevels, there were four 500-pound bulk samples extracted historically. Turns out they graded themselves 19 grams per ton each. And there was a vertical raise about 100 feet or 30 meters in height, meter in diameter. It itself graded over its length 28 grams per ton. So almost immediately we knew that this system is far richer. The high grade is more prevalent across the entire known mineralization, and it's straight from surface, delineated only down to 180 meters. So tip of the iceberg.
Okay, but you give me the highlights, and you know, obviously twinning makes things a lot easier. So maybe we start with what did you walk into? What was the business that you set out to try and create? And then how are you going to get that thing funded?
Yeah, good question. And what I walked into in November was a firm that had $2 million in debt, $7 million market cap, and no cash. And an historic resource, as I just pointed out, that hadn't begun its journey into a 43-101 compliant resource. So that effort, when we moved in, we raised just about $3 million. Actually, it was $3 million within as many months. In fact, we raised the first million 4 days post my announcement. Then 2 weeks later, upscaled to two, and then upscaled again to three before Christmas. That fully funded us for our first drill campaign that started in March. We also cleaned up the debt and then, of course, began our march moving forward to develop the camp and execute on the drilling, which we've done. So along the way, we've seen our market cap grow from $7 million up to between 35 and 40 now, and with that, you know, a healthy cash balance.
So it was a simple case of what you walked into. The company was cash constrained because Well, why? I mean, if you've been looking at some, if it's taken 3 million to unlock the value, in, as you're outlining these high grades, you've done some twinning and it's thrown up some big headline grabbing numbers. But what have they done wrong up until that point?
Visibility. It really wasn't known at all. The story wasn't out there. The team that was running it are exceptional on the ground individuals in terms of exploration and prospecting, but in terms of capital markets and moving, you know, larger scale projects up through the pipeline, there was a different skill set required. So bringing that in, bringing this to light in terms of the market is really been the catalyst for that immediate value growth. So many of my peers throughout the industry came knocking, you know, where did you find this? How did this come out of the ether? Well, it's been there all along. It was originally discovered in the late 40s. They ran out of money at the same time Timmins, Kirk and Lake discoveries were being developed. And it went into stasis for nearly 40 years, stayed off the radar and private ownership and some of it in locked up in the courts and so forth. But it wasn't until 2013 that our founder, John LeLever, pulled that together, put it into the signature vehicle, and did their best right up to, you know, my appointment to try to develop it and move it forward. But you have to attract funds. And Matthew, there's three pillars that really I've focused on to bring that value forward and what we continue to as a recipe for success. One is the asset itself, bringing light to the fact that it is a high quality, you know, world-class asset in a world-class jurisdiction of which we hold 90% of an entire pristine greenstone belt. That said, the team is the second one, bolstering the team that we have with the current advisory board additions that we've done, bringing in world-class cross-functional support, that being geology, mine building, world-class metallurgy, capital markets, you name it, it's in there. We've checked those boxes. So we've strengthened the team. We've accelerated our marketing program and are now working in parallel with that to not only bolster the historic data set, but also build upon it with the new drilling.
So
multi-pronged approach.
Right. Okay. On the people front, look at your background, fairly blue chip, Yamana, et cetera, in that. Some big deals that you've, big transactions, billion-dollar transactions that you've done. This is a tiny company, and it's around 30 million market cap now, 7 when you arrived. A whole bunch of different problems. Why are you the right guy to take this company forward?
I think having the visibility and the, you know, experience to see how that pans out on the other end of the pipeline in terms of moving something through a pipeline, getting it into production, and then achieving production that's responsible, predictable, reliable, de-risked. It all feeds back into what you're growing and developing in the first place. That is a core learning in this industry. You can't cut corners in the development of a resource or the extraction of it. So taking that knowledge and experience along with the fabulous team I have and focusing that on this asset, we're doing that simply because, Matthew, it is a world-class asset. When I go through and check a number of boxes that would identify that in near surface, mesothermal, high grade, high density of ounces, undeformated, on and on we can go, check boxes. The asset, the right DNA is there. And the fact that it's been overlooked, the land package that we've grown was unclaimed, for us to consolidate that, position the asset and then focus our efforts. That is really the opportunity that we see and have in front of us to really take this from an extremely undervalued position into something that represents valuations that you see today.
Right. So you've raised $3 million. You're doing a bit of drilling yourself, and we've seen some nice numbers we've seen announced earlier this month, a few days ago. What are you going to be able to do with $3 million? You're aiming for this 43-101 update, but in terms of a resource, it's not going to be particularly large. Is that just the first step because you're confident in planting a flag in the sand because you're confident that you can go and raise money to move that resource into something that may get noticed?
Exactly. The first two stages, I use the analogy with our team that you know, we've built a rocket, we've moved it out to the launch pad in November, and January we hit the launch button. So we've burned through stage one, if you will, rockets. That really is an analogy for positioning. We've positioned the firm, as I said, financially. We've now positioned it technically on the ground in terms of developing an incredible camp that is efficient. We own our own drill rig. It's de-risked that manner. And we have an excellent team. That's allowed us to initiate and complete the drilling when we said we'd do it. So in terms of execution, that's what we've been doing with the 3 million positioning and beginning to execute. With that, and the completion of this drill program and the results that are coming out, it's certainly positive in the way that it's indicating this is growing in scale. And we are beginning to understand what's happening in parts of the deposit as we find the shoulders of it. Moving forward, Matthew, if for the balance of this year, the positioning theme is the same. We are in a position now, and we'll likely be bolstering our financial capabilities throughout the summer and further positioning ourselves for the next stage of drilling and data collection. In other words, this deposit is screaming at us to move faster. Obviously, our goal to bring accretive share value to shareholders as quickly as possible, but responsibly as possible, is the key. So we continue the theme of positioning through this summer. We're acquiring a second drill rig. In other words, we'll have two rigs of our own crew to run those. So from that perspective, we've pushed the risk that so many of our peers have off the table with the rush now for securing drill resources. It's pretty challenging out there for those to find that. The fact that we're securing that and positioning ourselves to look at a tripling of the scale of drill campaign that we started with in March at 3,000 meters, we'll be looking at close to 10,000 meters commencing in the fall, and that will be over a broader range of the existing historic resource and also moving to depth. In parallel with that, just to sort of cap off that answer, we are moving a second train down the tracks. I indicated that we have a massive land package with incredible district potential, some of which is incredibly rare from my travels throughout the globe looking for this sort of recipe. We are working and advancing on regional exploration packages as we speak. So with the completion of the drilling, we're now conducting an aerial-borne geophysic program over now the entire land package. LIDAR, we're flying as well starting this week. And more importantly, on the ground, we're running an induced polarity or IP 3D program on the Lingman Lake deposit itself. That will ground penetrate down to about 500 meters across a span of about 3 kilometers east-west and about a kilometer north-south. So a massive data chunk for us to help fingerprint the existing discovery that we have, which is very well defined through the 28,000 meters of drilling it has. But also allow us to be much more efficient and targeted with that next program. So you can see that we are positioning not only through the financial gatherings, but also beginning to deliver on that positioning value to shareholders.
It's a tough one to kind of take in, but you know, because of a company of your size, we see lots of them each week, pretty much saying the same thing. It's the district-wide, you know, it's a district-scale opportunity. We've yet to get meaningful information, but we have targets, we have anomalies, and you know, it's a kind of patois which for investors, it's hard to kind of work your way through without understanding how you're going to come at it. So, you know, $3 million and you need some flow through money coming in here. It's like, how does that actually meaningfully get spent? Do you have to spend it a different way? Again, you come from a big company background, so do you have to spend it a different way as a junior to actually give some certainty over what the future could look like, to give certainty over the cash which you're going to come go chasing after you've you know got through this drill program of yours?
You do.
So what's that narrative?
It's an excellent question. You know, I refer to our logo, the discipline and the execution needed to build integrity. What we have done is specific towards that path. It's achieving a stable base of operations. It's achieving early stage proof of concept results, which we're getting from the drilling, and positioning then for scale, which is what we're doing. The difference with our firm, Matthew, and I'll clarify this quite sharply, and it's the reason I'm sitting in this chair when you're surrounded with a plethora of opportunities out there, as you pointed out, and the fact that I've spent the last 15 years evaluating them. You know, the filter's pretty fine in terms of looking for this. The point is what we have is a discovery in hand. This is 234,000 ounces historic, right at surface, very well defined in a pristine greenstone belt, meaning, you know, geologically, there's tremendous opportunity. I know you hear that, but you don't hear folks that have 300 square kilometers, 90% of a greenstone belt in Ontario, Canada. So you put all these elements together, the fact that we have the discovery, that we're really a resource developer right now. We're not, we are looking regionally to find more of these. Our geologists believe that Lingman Lake may not even be the center of mass of this system, that we may have what I refer to as other icebergs. But right now in hand, we have the immediate opportunity. And this is what captured my attention, is that it's incredibly drill ready. The more you drill this, the more it returns value. In other words, the discovery's been made. We have to now develop it. We have to find its extents in terms of near surface, what we're doing, and we're beginning to push it to depth and using more and more data to drive those decisions. So we're past discovery with Lingman Lake. We are resource development, but we also have tremendous regional growth potential to parallel that. And the Lingman Lake is 80% of our efforts and focus and funding, to be clear. We are focused on the known and moving.
Well, that's what I wanted to get at, Robert. Okay, that's what I wanted to get at, because small companies with not a lot of cash or district-wide ambitions, the cash gets wasted. So the discovery is made historically. You are regenerating that and being a resource developer. That's what you want to be. It's going to require a whole bunch of cash, but you are honed in on where the value can be created quickest, because that's what you need to do as a junior, isn't it?
That is exactly what we're doing. Yes. The strategy is pointing and supporting that rapid growth, but responsible and disciplined. We're not cutting corners. We're going through the data. I know the drill. I know what integrity is required to attract and attract a producer level interest in moving a project through the pipeline, which obviously is what we're working to do, is responsibly discover, grow, and pass on this resource. That is what we're focused on. And as I've explained earlier, our ability to scale that up and accelerate that is what we're doing now and positioning for in the fall. So that means more growth of the existing resource, more ounces, more scale. What I've already explained through the data sets, what we believe will be an increase in grade as well. So it's poised to grow quite rapidly. Obviously, the horse is just bolted from the gate.
Well, exactly. But let's talk about that. Let's talk about that, because I think it's interesting. You think that the grade is could be better. Is you've done some twinning to basically validate historic data, and the correlation is quite strong. 94% you're talking about, right? But moving forward to increase this resource, you're going to need to do a different type of drilling, right? You're going to need to come at it differently. Otherwise, the growth is going to be a little bit slower. So what are you focused on? Where's the money going?
Primarily, it's in, we're drilling for scale. So you don't drill at tight meterages as you're working to grow a resource to bring in ounces at, you know, high measured and indicator categories. We know it's there. What we need to do is prove that through the drilling. So that means a well-defined, focused drilling for scale program, if you will. So our spacing, it puts us within an inferred category, let's say, anywhere from 50 to 100 meters, depending on what we're doing. But moving to depth, it would step that manner, step out and strike in parallel with that. So it's really attacking, you know, multiple horizons, multiple dimensions of scale development. Once we know where the shoulders and the extent and the thickness and depth of this is, and we don't expect the depth to be picked up anytime soon. We know mesothermal deposits run kilometers deep. I myself worked at the Hemlo operations, cutting my teeth as a mine engineer for nearly 8 years, and that thing is exceeded 2.5 kilometers depth. You look at pure gold, you look at Red Lake, mesothermal deposits as well that have achieved depths of over 2.5 kilometers. So we know this thing is the tip of an iceberg at only 180 meters depth right at surface. But it's there for begging to do what we've just explained, and that is that, you know, drill for scale, move quickly to determine where the extents of the mineralization is, and then, of course, overprinting more and more data with that, and eventually moving towards infilling over time. But right now, we just don't know how big it is. And that's our number one goal, is to determine how big it is and map that out accordingly.
So what are you going to need to come back to the market and tell them after your drill program to be able to raise the money that you're going to need to go forward? What's your expectation?
I think much of what I've just said, that the potential is in hand to grow this rapidly.
Give us more meat to the bone than that, because it's, you know, potential, it's all too generic. You're going to have to say, we have worked out the extent of this thing. We have increased the resource. We have spent the money wisely to give us some more. I mean, what are the numbers they're going to expect to see from you?
They are going, well, we're in the middle of generating that from our first drill result, Matthew, as well as the geophysics that parallel it. So in about a month's time, let's say, we expect to have the remainder of our drill assays in hand. It's been brutally slow at the assay labs. But with that coming through the pipe, with the geophysics program I mentioned in terms of fingerprinting, driving the data set to 500 meters deep, we expect to have a roadmap that will be very clear in terms of what our next steps are to grow this definitively in terms of ounces and scale. And again, as I said, the hope to see the grade rise as well. I mean, everyone hopes that, but the data set that we have is telling us that. But per my point, gathering the data that we've set out to gather in our first round, the drilling, the geophysics, positioning, using that data to then reposition, double our efforts in terms of drilling, but triple our efforts in terms of meters into the ground, point is that we will be growing that scale ounces accordingly. That's really it. There's, you know, it's ounces and scale. The ounces are there. The scale is there. We're ready to dive into that once we have the data set and the roadmap and direction in hand. We're just not going to throw meters and throw caution to the wind and drill everywhere and hope this thing's going to grow no matter where we drill. No, as I said, we're using data to drive that. We were trying to be as responsible as possible with every dollar that a shareholder provides. And so that when that goes into the ground, you're getting tangible value back from the drill bit with it. And that's what we're doing.
Okay, great. Talk to me a little bit about the team, because it sounds like the old team plus you and the money you've brought along. Is it as simple as that?
Plus a bolstering of the advisory board, as I mentioned. So Paulo and myself, Paulo likes to say, and I think it's a good analogy, we're back to back in a gunfight, so to speak. He's got a tremendous depth and breadth of capital markets experience. Mine, of course, as you know, is on the operating side of the industry, as well as corporate development and M&A. So you combine that. We complement ourselves quite well and have brought in a cadence, if you will, of urgency, pace, methodology, discipline, you name it, to really be the fuel for this. We've added to that with our advisory board. We brought in a gentleman that we announced several weeks back, Ricardo Welohorsky. This gentleman's a world-class mine builder, metallurgist. He's worked on projects like Detour, Cerro Moro for Yamana. He's worked to build several or at least a few mines for Barrick Gold. He's worked for other, you know, firms relating to the diamond industry and so forth. So between his project development management and capabilities of mustering and growing a project rapidly on the ground, but also his world-class metallurgical capabilities, that underpins where we are today, because we do expect, with the additional data that we're poised to begin drilling, returning in terms of growth and ounces, but also growing our data set and having it within a modern 43-101 compliant environment, what we're also doing in parallel, we're looking to initiate metallurgical early stage test work towards the end of the year as well. So having that on our pin is great. We have Dan Denbaugh, a capital markets gentleman based in the United States, managed $1 billion funds. He's incredibly intuitive with that end of the capital markets. We have two world-class geologists, one being a geologist as well as an ex-BMO analyst, John Hayes, incredible gentleman, very deep knowledge set in terms of geology. We also have Dr. Scott Bevins bolstering that as well as a geologist, backing up our chief geologist, Walter Hainch, who is part of the founding group with our founder, John LeLever. So really, that cross-section I spoke of earlier, Matthew, that is a very stable, strong leg under the stool next to asset quality and those two attracting the funding to grow. It's something that I've paid close attention to and will continue to. I believe in the concept of team and surrounding yourself with the best people out there so that the best result can be obtained for shareholders. And that's what we're doing.
They're quite expensive though, aren't they?
Surprisingly not. The people that I've surrounded myself with through the years are like-minded. They understand the process of value generation. This isn't a situation where everyone jumps in, siphons from the firm for their own personal benefit and exits. That's cutting corners, you know, in terms of developing a resource responsibly. We are the opposite. You have a like-minded group all pulling on the same rope in the same direction at the same time. It's an ideal circumstance.
Okay. So what does that mean? You're all paid in shares and dividends and warrants and.
Yeah. I mean, our salaries are, you know, quite modest compared to what we've stepped out of, you know, from the corporate side. And that's understandable, and the potential for growth within the share itself, our equity long-term compensation through options is modest, but at the same time, the opportunity to grow that substantively is what energizes us. The fact that we have the skill sets collectively and capabilities to focus that and do that rapidly with an asset, as I've already outlined, is rare and world-class. It comes down to, I'll point to the logo again, discipline and execution. And that's what we've been focused on. And since I've joined in November, we have completed and executed on every single item we said we would. And now we're positioning with those results, as we said, over the next month to do that at another level with a greater sense of pace and urgency in terms of moving quicker, bring value quicker.
Robert, thank you very much. You've set the scene. Just need to deliver. So we're delighted to have you back on the show and see how you're getting on. Could be building something quite nice here.
Thank you, Matthew. I appreciate it. Looking forward to it.